Hello, everybody. This is Georgianne Hughes, and this is The Bite Show. And this is a very special presentation tonight with our own pastor, Douglas Riggs, and his special guest, Lynn Marzulli. And Lynn Marzulli is the author of the Nephilim Trilogy. The Nephilim Trilogy made the CBA best sellers list and continues to fascinate readers a decade after the first book in the series was published. Lynn Marzulli also received an honorary doctorate from Pacific International University for his work on the Nephilim Trilogy. Lynn Marzulli is also the author of the nonfiction work, and you must get this, people, you must get this book, Politics, Prophecy, and the Supernatural. So this book really is packed with hard-hitting news. It's a huge expose of how the current political landscape may bring about ancient biblical prophecies, which they may trigger supernatural events that are foretold in the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation. And I'm just going to turn this over to these two gentlemen. They have a lot of things to tell you tonight. And God bless you both, sirs.
Yes, thank you, Georgianne. Thank you for your availability.
Oh, absolutely.
And I appreciate Lynn being available. And I met Lynn last August at a conference in Ohio with Russ Dizdar and Gary Kaw. And I just really appreciated the time that he took to explain to the audience the background that most of us don't have in dealing with where we are in history. And so I'm very much appreciative of having Lynn Marzulli on. The work that I'm doing, as some already know, is working with the generational satanic ritual abuse.
Yes.
And there's a core group that have reported having to produce hybrid offspring as per Genesis 6. And Lynn Marzulli has come at it from a different venue on the theme of alien abduction and the hybrid breeding programs that are going on in various venues. And so I just want to welcome Lynn Marzulli and thank you for being available. And I just wanted to ask you, when you're ready, Lynn, is your most recent book, Prophecy, Politics, and the Supernatural, you had a reason for writing that and a purpose. And so when you're ready, saying whatever you'd like to say, just give us a little introduction. Is what has brought you into the field that you're now focusing on as a ministry to the Lord and ministry to his people and to this generation?
Well, first of all, Georgianne and Doug, thanks for having me on The Bite Show. It's my first time here, and you've given me a very warm welcome already. I feel right at home. And to answer your question, Doug, basically, I had written the Nephilim Trilogy, which it's obviously a fictional work, but a lot of research went into those novels. And what I found is that I was not welcome on many talk shows and many radio interviews because people looked at it as a fictional work, and they said, well, what is this man going to tell us, because these are works of fiction. And so I was sort of taken aback by this, realizing that I had just a plethora of information that had gone into those books. Why they are novels, and they are, all the characters are composites of different people, and certainly the situations are made up, most of them, right out of my head, but they're basically based on research. And so what I did is I took a look at that research, and actually my father was sort of instrumental in this. He said, you know, you've got all this information, why not sort of write an amalgamation of, you know, politics, prophecy, and the supernatural? And that's how the book sort of came into being. And of course, every time you write a book, it takes on a life of its own, and oftentimes the premise that you start with is not what you wind up with. And what sort of amazed me about the book is, because I really felt like finally I had connected some dots in a concise way where the reader can who knows nothing about ufology or the phenomenon that's going on globally, by the way, it has been for decades, can jump in, and by the end of the book he can at least make his own decision on whether he believes this or whether he wants to read more or investigate more. But I find that most people who read the book become true believers, at least on some level. They'll maybe not accept it outright. There are those people who do accept it outright, but there are others that want to know more and will start to do their own investigation. There are 25 pages of footnotes on the back of that book. So everything has chapter and verse, not only from the Bible, but from different source material that I'm just making this stuff up or pulling rabbits out of my head or pointing to Wikipedia with nothing wrong with Wikipedia, but there's others, many sources that come in that I use to sort of make my point and to tie and connect all these dots together. Basically, the idea of politics, prophecy, and the supernatural, and there's this phrase that I constantly bring the reader back to, the present political landscape is in direct correlation to the supernatural events that happened, in some cases, millennia ago. I was on a show today, and they were asking me, why is it that here in the West, people sort of poo-poo the supernatural, and that's because Darwinism and the Age of Reason and the scientific method, all those dynamics that happened well over a century ago now have really shaped the way people look at the world, shaped the worldview. And yet in this country we celebrate supernatural events, i.e. Christmas, and of course Easter, not Ishtar, but the resurrection, where we believe the God-man Jesus, and Christmas is born of a virgin, on all those prophecies which indicate where he was going to be born in the time of his birth. And then later on Resurrection Sunday, we celebrate the fact that he rose from the dead 3 days later. Again, prophecy thousands of years before the event happening, and fulfilled in the one man, Yahshua or Jesus. So we celebrate these supernatural events, and that leads us, it sort of begs the question, if these supernatural events happened in the past, are they happening now? Or different supernatural events? And the answer to that, in my opinion, is a resounding yes. We see the supernatural manifesting globally like never before. Although I will say this, Doug and Georgianne, right now it appears that there's sort of a lull, and I'm calling it the calm before the storm. I feel something is about to really hit the global scene. Not sure what it is. I always look to the Middle East. Things are certainly heating up there. But the whole UFO phenomena has sort of pulled back a little bit. Actually, not a little bit, sort of a lot. It's not like it was several months ago where stuff was going on all over the planet. It has really pulled back in the last 30 days. So that's kind of what the book is about, and you know, we can talk more about it as time permits.
So my interest, of course, is to try to collate or to synchronize the work that I've been doing with the survivors of generational satanic ritual abuse who have been programmed by Nazi doctors, highly structured through trauma-based mind control, and all these programs that have come out of Nazi Germany and the different medical scientists that were brought over under the CIA, et cetera, to create, you know, various operatives within the CIA. But it goes much deeper than that, as Russ has talked about in his book, The Black Awakening. But the people that I'm working with goes beyond the super soldier. It comes right down to people being structured through trauma-based mind control based on their bloodlines. They're actually turned into portals, if you will, so that the enemy has been able to interface with our humanity in such a way is to create portals through trauma. And then with the women, they have been able to recreate the exact same scenario that we see in Genesis 6 and reproducing these hybrid offspring in order to populate the world and create a situation that will suit the enemy's final move in these last days. And so in the area that you're working, Lynn, it hasn't been with survivors of ritual abuse. But there's been a move in terms of the enemy strategy to bring forth, as in the days of Noah, these hybrid species. So how would you follow up on that in terms of where we're headed in history and what is the significance of the enemy's plans in the days in which we live?
Well, it's interesting, Doug, that we come from two different perspectives on this, and yet what we're seeing is that they actually interface with one another. They dovetail together quite nicely. Jesus tells us something, Yeshua tells us something, and points to a time. He says, when the Son of Man returns, it'll be like the days of Noah. Of course, he is the Son of Man. That's who he's addressing himself. And that immediately begs the question, what differentiates the days of Noah than any other time in history? And in my opinion, it is the presence of the B'nai Elohim. And by the way, thank you for sending me that wonderful paper this morning. I forwarded it. It was very timely, Doug. It was an expose on Genesis 6, a theological exposition on Genesis 6, which I thought was very much right on and well presented. And a friend of mine had just been to a conference, prophecy conference, and of course they won't go to the supernatural. They won't look at the supernatural. They'll tie all this prophecy together, but they won't. Most of these prophecy guys never look at what's manifesting on the planet. They won't go there for whatever reason.
That's
and so they were trying to say that the Genesis 6 phenomena of the Nephilim were actually the ungodly line of Cain, that whole argument. So
yeah.
It was very interesting. It was perfect, you know, synchronistic that you sent me that, and I forwarded it off, and we'll see what happens to it. But Jesus points to a time when he's going back to days of Noah, and immediately begs the question, what differentiates those days? And in my opinion, it is the presence of the B'nai Elohim, the fallen angels. And by the way, that phrase is always used for angels. It doesn't differentiate between the good guys or the bad guys, but it's always used for angels all throughout the Old Testament. So to somehow take that phrase and torture it, literally torture it, so it comes up to be the ungodly line of Cain, in my opinion, is beyond the pale. What it points to is a time in history where these fallen angels came down and they took the women of Earth for wives. They actually engaged in marriage with these women and had sexual relations with them. But the offspring, the hybrid, was this fallen angel human hybrid called the Nephilim. Part of that may have been, well, definitely was, the offspring were giants, and they could have been between 15 and 35 feet tall, and that's open for debate, and different people have different ideas on that. The bottom line is, what are we seeing now? And here's where the jump is, Doug, that, you know, Jesus himself is pointing to that time, and I love it. It's like my critics and people who take the other side of the aisle or look at this as some sort of a Canaanite invasion. Well, how does it work for now? If that's true, let's go on their theory that it's the ungodly line of Cain or whatever. Okay, so what differentiates the days of Noah, the ungodly line of Cain? How could that possibly relate to our present day situation? And of course, it really doesn't. I mean, you don't get giants and you don't have the flood, literally, which is the result of this demonic hybridization going on millennia ago, which resulted in the flood, which wiped out everybody except for eight people. And it says Noah is pure in all his generation. It's not talking about his sin. It's talking about his bloodline. And this of course, what ties into what you're doing, Doug, and it dovetails so neatly. It's just amazing. But this breeding program by these fallen angels is very vigorous. Has been going on for decades. And there is a goal. There is a person by the name of Dr. David Jacobs, who I interviewed for my alien interview book, and he actually is the first person to lead off the book. And it's chilling stuff. I remember when I read his books a while back, several years ago, and I could only read so much at a sitting. It was so overwhelming, his research, because he was literally in the belly of the beast at this point, and he realized that the phenomena was not some sort of a break with reality or a schizophrenic episode or whatever, that or a psychotic episode, that these were real events that were happening to people. And he realized this because he kept interviewing different people who allegedly were abducted, and they all had the same story or similar stories, and yet there was no collusion between them. And he walked around in sort of a daze for 6 months trying to get his head around the fact that this was real. And of course, what it mimics is the Genesis 6 account. Women are taken at night. They are awakened from their bed, or from their sleep. their spouse is shut off, and these abductees talk about their spouses. It's like they're switched off. And we can get into that a little later if you want, because there's actually biblical references to that type of thing specifically. When Peter is freed in the jail cell by the angel, all the guards are literally switched off. They look like they were asleep.
Another interesting point, too, I've read about some of these instances, Lynn, and even dogs that are in the house are switched off. You know, and dogs are very sensitive. You know, they would react. But there have been people that said even the dog wouldn't warn them.
Which is sobering and chilling at the same time. It's,
oh, yes.
It's very nasty stuff. The women, if you're a female and you're about to be abducted, you awaken, your husband's asleep, you find yourself unable to move, and yet your eyes are open and you're fully conscious, but you're unable to scream. And you start floating above your bed, you look down and you look to the side and there are 3 to 6, gray aliens, which are now enculturated, by the way, in things like the Ever Ready battery commercial.
Yeah.
Where the little bunny rabbit's fighting the drum and he's beamed up into the belly of a ship and there they are. I mean,
yeah.
It's unbelievable how we're, are sort of programmed to accept these things. And you're floated through a wall, or glass, or a window, or whatever, and taken into an examination room. You find yourself on a table. Remember, you're conscious the whole time. You're absolutely terrified. These entities move in the climate of fear. They feed off of it. They want it there. They breed it. They try to manipulate it as much as possible because they feed off of it. And of course, you're terrified, and you're obliging, you know, what they're trying to do. The Luciferians, the satanic beings that are responsible for this, their currency is one of fear, and they move in it. They thrive in it. They relish in it. And when you're laying awake like that on a table, and these so-called extraterrestrials, which are, in my opinion, demons and fallen angels, usually a larger entity will enter the room, and it can shapeshift into pretty much anything. It can look like a tall Nordic. It can look like a reptilian, you know, lizard-type skin. It can look like a mantis-type. It can be short and sort of troll-like. All sorts of different images are seen. And they will begin gynecological experimentation. The woman is then deposited back. She awakes the next morning, and there's a lot of side effects that happen from that. She feels a lot of headaches, maybe abdominal cramps, markings, blood, all these different signs, and yet part of her memory usually is erased, where she's not sure, did I dream this? What's going on? Anyway, to cut to the chase, in the third month, or the first, at the end of the first trimester, she's then reabducted. The fetus is then taken from her, and then she's redeposited back. She thinks she's had a miscarriage in most cases. And of course, this is all documented. There's another woman that comes on the record in the alien interviews, Karina Sables, who was an abductee, and one of her abductions was actually witnessed by a group of people. They actually saw her and 9 other people being abducted all at the same time. All these people had radiation, high levels of radiation, radiation burns, their hair began to fall out, radiation sickness, poisoning, all this high strangeness was going on, and she, you know, talks about her experiences. So there is a breeding program. Later on, these women are usually abducted 4 or 5 years after the fact that the fetus has been removed. This abduction gets even stranger, according to Dr. Jacobs and other people that I've interviewed, where they will meet the hybrid, and this goes back 20 or 30 years now. The original hybrids looked more alien, large black eyes, very thin, sickly-looking, straggly hair. According to Jacobs' research and others, apparently now the breeding program has sort of reached its peak, its conclusion. The hybrids can pass. They no longer have the deep, you know, the big black wraparound eyes type thing. They can pass for human, which, of course, again, mimics what we're looking at back in Genesis 6, as in the days of Noah, so it will be when the Son of Man returned. And, Doug, this dovetails this whole Luciferic satanic inbreeding, which the Nazis started, and to me, it's all interconnected. They're all parts of the same jigsaw puzzle, and we're seeing it manifest now in real time. And yet, unfortunately, the churches are completely asleep with this. They won't discuss the issue, and so people are blind to it. They have no idea what's going on. which, and again, thank you, Georgianne, for allowing me on the program to voice this. It's information that needs to get out, and then people can decide what they want to do with it.
Now, if I can just back up, because you used a number of terms I'm not sure our listening audience really picked up on when you mentioned B'nai HaElohim. I thought I'd just ask the listening audience just to turn to Genesis 6, and I'll just go through this briefly. It begins with, "Now it came about when men began to multiply on the face of the land, and daughters were born to them." So these daughters are not bloodline daughters like what I'm working with. These are daughters of them that were born to them. And, of course, these are descendants of Adam. Then it says that the sons of God, and that's the term he used, the B'nai HaElohim.
Mm-hmm.
He said this term was only used in the New Testament. It's important that it's just not B'nai Elohim, it's B'nai HaElohim. In other words, the definite article is in the Hebrew. And that particular phrase only and always refers to angels. Mm-hmm. So it occurs here in verse 2 and also in verse 4. It occurs again in Job 1, where the sons of God and Satan came and presented themselves before God. And it's used again in Job chapter 2, the B'nai HaElohim, or the sons of God, and again in Job 38, verse 7. So it's very, very clearly that these are angels. These are not, this is not the so-called godly line of Seth. In fact, the Septuagint, the Greek translation, has Gigantes, which really has to do with earthborn, but it's translated giants. And it's interesting that in the Septuagint, Gigantes is used in verse 4 for both Nephilim and also the mighty men who were of old, the Ha-Giverim, the heroes.
Uh-huh.
Now, so if you go back to this, we see that they took wives for themselves, whomever they choose. This is not a mutual agreement. This is not a husband and wife entering into a marriage relationship. They took these wives. And it says, these are the daughters of men, verse 2. The word there in the Hebrew is Adam, daughters of Adam. And they were beautiful. And then we see the response. The Lord said, "My spirit will not always strive with man forever, because he is also flesh. Nevertheless, his days shall be 120 years. So there's a probationary period before the judgment would come. And notice the context of this judgment is the result of this eruption, the descent of these watchers, as the Book of Enoch, and I know that's not a biblical, but at least that's historical in terms of, it gives us a framework, say there were 200. Now, in verse 4, it says the Nephilim, Nephal, it's in the plural, it comes from the verb to fall. And so these hybrid offspring are that which is the result of the fall of angels. In fact, Jude says in verse 6 that these angels that are now imprisoned, and that's certainly not the ones we're dealing with in exorcisms and the ones that oppress and that we're doing spiritual warfare, we see in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, that these specific, and Jude 6, that this specific group of angels were cast into prison, to Tartarus.
Mm-hmm.
And the spiritual warfare we're in, as mentioned by Paul in Ephesians chapter 6, they're not in prison.
Correct.
So we know that this specific group of fallen angels have been incarcerated by God as a result of this sin. So verse 4 says, the Nephilim were on the earth in those days, that is the days of Noah, and also afterward. Well, when is afterward? Numbers 13, verse 33, mm-hmm. They were in the land of Canaan, when the seed of Abraham and the children of Israel were to go in and dispossess that real estate as their inheritance. And so the enemy had already pre-positioned himself to attack the seed of the woman in Genesis 3:15.
Okay, I have a question. How did they get there if, you know, when there was this flood? Because they erupt again after the flood, and they use that word eruption. So how are we to look at that? Where did they come from if, you know, everybody was wiped out?
Well, that's an important thing. If God wiped out the ungodly line, as it were, of Cain in the flood, then that's a good question. But
yeah.
Since it's not an issue of human genetics, but it is a second and more confined eruption of fallen angels that that to reproduce them again, because in the flood, it took care of that. So there had to be another incursion.
Yes.
And what's interesting about that, Georgianne, is that the commandment that God gave to Joshua to wipe out this particular second eruption in Canaan, they didn't fulfill it.
Right.
So there are still Nephilim strains of Nephilim gene that it had their extent as of today.
Yes.
Now I want to get back to the word giants there. You know, some have said, well, these not necessarily had to be of great stature, although we seem to have archaeological data for this. But they were giant in intellect, and they were giant in strength.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the super soldiers that have been reported today, they said fourth generation super soldiers. The report by Duncan Finnegan, I think is his name. He said he's a first generation super soldier. In the fourth generation, that two have lifted an Abrams tank. Now, this is beyond the normal physics.
Yes.
And it says they were men, they were mighty men, were of old, men of renown, or men of great name. And so when we look all over the world and we see these the various ziggurats and the Baalbek over there in Lebanon, these huge
mm-hmm.
stones.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, here we have these engineering feats that even modern-day engineers and architects with other architects with the machinery we have today, they could not even build them today. And so we have the heroes of mythology in the Greeks, which is of course been embellished. But here's the source. This is the fountainhead of all that which would explain what happened in the days of Noah. And then just, I'm going to turn this back over to you. And then when Jesus says, as it was in the days of Noah, so will be the return of the Son of Man.
Yeah.
G.H. Pember said that there was two eruptions in first in Genesis and then a second more limited and confined in advance of the seed of Abraham occupying the land. And he said there would be a third and final eruption just prior to the return of the Son of Man. And may I just say, what is the point of the enemy's doing this? He is attacking the seed of the woman in Genesis 3:15. His attempt is to corrupt the human gene pool
yeah.
so there would not be a savior to bring redemption to fallen mankind. And
exactly.
I'll turn it back over to you, Lynn.
Yeah, and I really enjoyed your overview of Genesis 6 and basically what happened. And I do concur that there was a second incursion. And it sort of begs the question, why does God keep allowing this? And I really have no answer to it. Until I understood the Nephilim, and the fallen angels, specifically from the book of Enoch, I never understood why the reason for the flood, really, and I never understood why the command to go out to Joshua and kill everything, burn everything, all the livestock, men, women, children, everything. It just seemed really severe.
Yeah.
But then when you realize that these were hybrids and that they were demonic hybrids, then all of a sudden everything comes into very sharp focus. And, of course, I appeared in an interview recently, I'm not trying to boast here, but the History Channel did like a 3-hour interview. And one of the questions they asked me was about Sodom and Gomorrah. And I said that perhaps the real sin of Sodom and Gomorrah was not a sexual sin, although it was sexual. But what we're looking at really is another incursion of fallen angels once again in that area, in that city, going after strange flesh. We don't know for sure, but in my opinion, it sort of leans to that direction. And this is this whole cosmic chess match, which I've come to call it, is sort of the basic for the book I'm working on now. But to get back on track, what we need to realize is that the supernatural is real, and it's manifesting. And unfortunately, here in the West, with Darwinism, with the scientific method, and all these, you know, scientific method is good in the sense that if I can't reproduce the experiment over and over again, then something is wrong. But what it does is it colors a person's worldview, specifically in tandem with Darwinism, that to exclude everything supernatural. A perfect example of this is Nat Geo. They've been doing it. Last week they had a special on crop circles, and they sort of went out of their way to color that our presentation, that it was just all the crop circles everywhere, all over the planet, were done by men. And they completely excluded from the program the work of Levengood and others of his ilk, which have been doing this for decades, and look at the crops and have scientific evidence, as long as your arm, about how the plants in the crop circles have exploded nodes. They are bent without any breakage to the plant, whereas the boards will leave like little scrape marks on the plants. These crops are pristine, plus they're woven. Well, Nat Geo excluded all that information and did it deliberately, because the moment we open that door, it's a door into the supernatural or a door into the unexplained, and Nat Geo doesn't have that worldview. There is no supernatural in Darwinism. Everything just happens by chance. So last night they did another program on mysterious plasma balls and, you know, balls of light flying all over the place. And some of these, and granted, are plasma balls. I mean, they're gas or swamp gas or this type of thing. But not all of these lights and these spheres are swamp gas.
Right.
It just doesn't work.
Right.
And yet that's what Nat Geo has to hold on to, because the moment it moves away from that paradigm, then it must seek some other paradigm, and that paradigm, of course, is the supernatural. Unfortunately, the church, all that to say this, that the churches, which should be really at the vanguard of the supernatural, have taken steps back from that and don't talk about it, don't teach their congregants about the supernatural, which is why most people have no idea how to apply, you mentioned this earlier, Ephesians 6 to our weapons are not carnal, but they're spiritual. And many Christians have no idea how to do warfare. If a demon manifested in most of these churches in America, most pastors would have no clue as to what to do with it. We had one up at the last church I was helping the pastor. I was not the senior pastor, but this woman was obviously demon possessed, and it manifested, and would manifest during the services, and they didn't know how to deal with it, which was unbelievable.
Yes.
You know, and these are the people that are supposed to know this stuff and travel in it, and yet they're completely blind to it. All that to say this, in my books, Politics, Prophecy, and Supernatural, and The Alien Interviews, I make a cogent case, in my opinion, for that these supernatural events are real, they're burgeoning, and they're not going away. And we need to start to examine them openly, dialogue about them, and not be afraid of, you know, not resort to ridicule and ad hominem attacks when someone brings this stuff up. But we need to really take a look at this thing, because in my opinion, Georgianne and Doug, we are in the days of Noah.
Yeah.
His coming is imminent. We're on the threshold. The birth pangs that Jesus himself talks about, Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, all talk about famines, earthquakes, signs, and the signs are here. The wars and rumors of wars. Those who have eyes to see, in my opinion, we are in the birth pangs. We're rapidly accelerating towards some sort of a climax, and certainly the supernatural is manifesting. We just need to open our eyes a little bit, and it's readily available to see.
Yeah. Of course, Paul makes that very clear, that with the coming of the son of perdition, the man of sin, in 2 Thessalonians 2, he'll come with all signs and lying wonders so as to deceive. For the purpose of deceiving, and it's all signs and lying wonders, and so this is the supernatural, and that of course is ramping up and increasing. I want to read just this short excerpt from the Nephilim Stargates by Thomas Horn, which is very pertinent and relevant to the work that I've been doing for 25 years. He's quoting an author here, Lee Martin, the Magicians, I guess. If I pronounce that right, he says, Hitler's aim was neither the founding of a race of supermen nor the conquest of the world. These were only means towards the realization of the great work he dreamed of. His real aim was to perform an act of creation, a divine operation, the goal of a biological mutation which would result in an unprecedented exaltation of the human race and the apparition of a new race of heroes and demigods and godmen. And then he goes on to say, some believe that was Genesis 6 and could be, again, the whole idea. And of course, he builds a good case for that. And so why Nazi Germany? the very people, for example, Dr. Josef Mengele, who was a doctor at Auschwitz and did all the twinning experiments. He was not only experimenting in terms of the physiological, but also psychological. There are people all over the United States that I've worked with that have reported being personally programmed by Dr. Mengele, that he was one of those protected under Operation Paperclip in this country. But what most people don't understand is that he wasn't just working for the CIA. Every person that I have worked with that has been with Mengele were members of the royal family, and these members of the royal family hired him to do the trauma-based mind control to perpetuate their agenda. When I say their agenda, this would be the contemporary kings of the earth that is mentioned in Psalm chapter 2. It's the kings of the earth agenda, in this case, hiring Dr. Mengele, Dr. John Bowlby, to trauma-based mind control, to so split the identity, to transfer principalities into the internal dissociative structure of these people's minds for one purpose, bring forth their Christ. But in order to bring forth their Christ, there has to be a change from Homo sapien to the New Age a mindset of Homo noeticus, a new man, a new species of man, the higher level of man reaching the zenith of the evolutionary process to where they have supernatural psychic powers. In other words, they are the Nephilim that are mentioned in Genesis 6. So how else are they described? These were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown, men of reputation, mighty men. These were the heroes. The women that I have worked with who have reported giving birth to Nephilim, here's how they refer to them. These are called the beautiful people. They call them the champions. And they are with us today. They are with us, and this whole goal that was a project, a major project and goal of the Nazi occult, the Fourth Reich, if you will, the Bilderberg Project, as some of them call it, the Genesis Project, as one of the girls I'm working with now call it, it has advanced by several degrees, and this one woman said as of 2002. She is the first non-bloodline person that she knows of. She's 20 years old, who has given birth to Nephilim, and she's non-bloodline. What does that tell us? We are at, that's the very point in history that now links us to Genesis 6. Because all the other women up to this point that I've worked with that have reported giving offspring, they had to be bloodline. They had to have preparation. And of all the demonization that represents the generational sin. So the fact that they have found a way to bring forth these Nephilim hybrid species through non-bloodline now, according to this report, puts us right at the point where the daughters of men produce offspring in Genesis 6. I think this is monumental. This is in all the years that I've worked, after 1 year of working with this young person, I've had to make a number of adjustments. And, of course, this program, Lynn, as you know, is introductory. We're going to have our folks back on in the near future and interview them and give us an SRA update, that is Satanic Ritual Abuse update, namely the Nephilim connection. That's following. But this is all introduction to that. So, if you'd like to pick up on this or have any thoughts, Lynn, go for it.
Again, I would certainly concur. And what's interesting is that you're getting the same information through a slightly different channel than I've gotten my information. But we're from our worldview and our paradigm, we look at everything through a biblical lens, and we see that the two really dovetail together. Look, I would agree that we're going to see something manifest on this planet. And you mentioned this slightly earlier. You said Satan comes with all signs and lying wonders, specifically from 2 Thessalonians chapter 4. What does that really mean?
You meant chapter 2.
Yeah, I'm sorry, exactly, you're right. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And thank you for the correction. And the church sort of skips over that. And what people, look, if and I say this over and over again, if we didn't have UFOs, and what I mean by that are all different types of craft, whether it's triangular, boomerang, rectangular, the classic dish-shaped balls of light that are seen to the tune of well over 300 people worldwide per month. Go back to 1950, it's one in the month of December. One sighting reported in the month of December. Fast forward to 2009, same month, it's in the hundreds, well over 300 that are being seen. So the phenomenon is real, burgeoning, and not going away. If that wasn't manifesting, I'd be looking to what was manifesting on the planet and be writing about that. And the reason for that is Israel has been regathered from the four corners of the earth, reestablishing its homeland. Here's the prophecy part of politics, prophecy of the supernatural, which fulfills, in my opinion, Ezekiel 37. And it's regathered from the four corners of the earth. The latter rain began to fall at the beginning of the 20th century, the latter part of the 19th century. The latter rain had not fallen literally for almost two millennia, and the earthquake stopped and the locusts stopped, you know, coming up from Africa and wiping everything out. So this is really the finger of God, in my opinion. The prophecy that's fulfilled in 1948 when Israel becomes a nation sort of starts the prophetic time clock ticking. And what we're seeing now, although the enemy has not yet been cast to earth, that's next, in my opinion, and we're going to see that. And when he comes, it says, woe to the inhabitants of earth. And we have, when he finally really shows up here, when he's really cast from the second heaven down, and Doug, you and I have talked about this off the air, and on the earth, it is going to be absolutely unlike anything we can possibly imagine. And so when it talks about Satan comes with all signs and lying wonders, the church and those of us who are, those of you who are listening, really need to get our heads around that it's not, that this guy, Satan, Lucifer, is a super scientist. He's a demented genius. And it's not just a one-trick pony type deal. It's all signs and lying wonders. And when the things start to manifest, it will be so overwhelming, in my opinion, that even the elect would be deceived if that were possible, which is why Jesus is pointing at that. Even the elect would be deceived if that were possible. Now, there are those of us, and three of us are on this show right now, talking about this very thing to warn. So it, not everyone is going to be deceived.
Right.
I consider myself an elect, not because of anything I've done or because I'm special, just because all the saints, I believe, are elect. But all of us who are born again, we're certainly elect in that sense. But when this thing hits, Doug and Georgianne, it will be so overwhelming that I believe it will cause what I term the great falling away, which is taken again from 2 Thessalonians, where it talks about the great falling away, where the word is apostasy in the Greek, apostasy. And it's an event. And I believe that when you start looking at 1 mile, 2 mile, 3 mile wide craft manifesting over the cities of the earth, this will completely overwhelm most people. And this goes, of course, hand in hand with Darwinism, which is what's been promulgated in our schools, in our colleges, and on television shows, and certainly in the scientific community, that all life evolved. We're not sure what the missing link is, but the so-called aliens will say that they are, in fact, the missing link. There's something I write about, and I'll just let me wrap this segment up by saying this, that these so-called extraterrestrials, which are nothing more than fallen angels, are promulgating what I call the alien gospel, which is this, that the so-called extraterrestrial ET, or the aliens, again, substitute fallen angels, but those in the exopolitic movement, those who believe that the extraterrestrials seeded all life on this planet, they created all life on this planet. They genetically manipulated us, early man, to create modern man, what we have today. They started the civilizations throughout the world. They started all the world's different religions and attempt to elevate us into some sort of a higher realm of consciousness. We worship them. Our ancestors worshipped these beings as gods in antiquity. Now they are back at this critical juncture in human evolution to help us into the next phase. This, I believe, is the coming great deception. And it syncs right along with Darwinism. I mean, it's exactly what the exopolitic crowd, that, you know, somehow life was seeded, panspermias, life was seeded here millions of years ago. When you look at, if you take a look at Ben Stein's movie Expelled, At the end of that movie, Ben Stein sits down with the premier Darwinist, Richard Dawkins, and he asks him, okay, where did life come from? If you're so, if creationism can't be taught or even discussed in academia, then why is it that, you know, we have to, where did life come from? Explain where life came from. Yeah. And Dawkins has no answer, of course. He's intellectually bankrupt. And he says, well, maybe life millions of years ago in another galaxy somehow started. And Stein just looks at him and just, and sort of smirks. It's the most intellectually bankrupt argument. And this is the best this guy's got to offer. And yet, he also, what I believe is, it's intellectual fascism in the sense that Dawkins won't allow any other discussion, certainly not creationism, certainly not some sort of a benevolent entity, call him God, if you will, that started everything ex nihilo. And we see, of course, when Jesus is walking the earth, he produces that. When he produces the fish and feeds 5,000, the fish have age. He produces them from nothing, or the changes of water from wine. He's manipulating matter and energy. Another discussion. But Dawkins is intellectually bankrupt, and he's also an intellectual fascist because he won't allow other ideas, or entertain any other ideas. And if you do, if you even bring up the idea of creationism in school, you can be expelled, literally, as that's the title of Stein's movie, or you lose your tenure and all sorts of other nasty things. And that's nothing short of intellectual fascism. It's something that we need to speak against.
Yes.
So all that to say that the pump is primed and ready for this. With all the plethora of movies and television shows and talk shows and Oprah Winfrey and the New Age movement, which, by the way, Pember talked about well over, you know, 120, 30 years ago. It's all been moving, accelerating towards this one event where we will see the man of sin, the son of perdition, the Antichrist, finally come on the scene and want to be worshipped. That's been the end game of the mystery of iniquity, which we're told about in Scripture for thousands of years, and it's ramping up. It's accelerating towards a climax.
Yes. You know, I would just like to recommend to the readers, if they could obtain a book, it's been put back into print. It's called Christianity and Anti-Christianity in Their Final Conflict by Samuel J. Andrews. This was written in 1899.
Wow.
When I read this, it was as monumental as reading Pember. It's as if he was contemporary, actually talking about all that was going to take place prior to the return of Jesus Christ. He perfectly defines the whole ideological landscape that we are now living in terms of New Age thinking. He didn't call it that, but
right.
He actually defined it. And this is a masterpiece. He's like a prophetic figure that was writing well before his time. So I highly recommend people getting that book. But what I wanted to ask is, it seems to me that these aliens seeded the population, and they're like the overseers, and at the right time they're going to those who have been paired going to help mankind make their final evolutionary leap to become one of the supermen. In other words, to be like Antichrist. Antichrist means a substitute for Christ. If they're overseeing this, then those who are the obstructionists, i.e. Christians or anyone who's not going along with the program, then they're going to have to be removed. Now, if Satan knows there will be a rapture, he knows the Bible, so he's got to come up with some kind of an answer that when the rapture occurs, he's got his bases covered, so people are going to buy whatever it is that he wants them to believe. And if the rapture is going to be excused by our enemy, that we are the obstructionist, i.e. Psalm chapter 2, verse 3, let us cast off their cords from us.
Mm-hmm.
And if that's somehow tied in with the removal of the restrainer, then with the removal of born-again believers, then they can believe the lie, as it says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, man can now be thrust forward to that place where the ultimate deception is man shall be God, and then we know in the middle of the tribulation all hell's going to break loose.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems to me that this whole UFO phenomenon and the messages that people are receiving is actually, at least in some of those messages, is preparing mankind for the event of the rapture. So when the rapture does occur, it'll be explained in such a way that it will seal the doom of those who haven't accepted the gospel. Do you have any thoughts or comments on that, Lynn?
Well, my friend Stephen, Dr. Stephen Ulish talks about, you know, the great harpazo of deception. That's the title of his book, and he addresses that very thing. I have heard this literally. I heard this first mentioned to me 35 years ago. 35 years ago, that exact scenario that you told me, 35 years ago, this guy who was a Christian but also came out of a UFO cult talked about exactly that thing, that when the rapture happens, the so-called aliens will say that, and look, not only that source, but when we look at the Federation of Light, and what the Federation of Light has said, exactly the same thing. Keep hearing this over and over again, that those people who are not quite evolved enough, I love this, not quite evolved enough to move into this new paradigm, this new, you know, this shift, paradigm shift that we're going to make on a planetary scale, will be taken somewhere else so they can kind of get up to speed. I just love that. And it's there. I mean, if you heard it once, you know, Doug and Georgianne, you would kind of go, well, you know, that's sort of interesting. But I've heard this same scenario for 35 years mouthed by this guy who was a born-again Christian but also came out of a UFO cult. The Federation of Light, Blossom Goodchild talks about it. New Age circles have talked about it. We keep hearing the same thing from abductees who come back and have these sort of messages. I mean, are all these people are tapping into the same source? And of course it is. It's priming the pump. It's getting things set up. So when this happens, the enemy, and again, this goes right back to the cosmic chess game, which we're talking about. It's move, counter move, move, counter move. And the enemy can see, and Doug, you gave me that analogy of, you know, the cornfield man. A man stands in a cornfield. He can see just around him. That's basically it. See the corn stalks in front of him, which is what this is the first heaven. We're bound by space and time. This is what we see. 1 second, 2 second, 3 second. We move in a linear fashion. The enemy is on top of a ladder, extension ladder, and a fire truck in that same field. So guess what? He can see the field and a few areas, the woods, and a couple of fields further on. In other words, his view, he can see further in time than we can. But the Lord, the Almighty, is in a helicopter way up in the sky, and guess what? He sees everything as it really is. But that analogy holds to this move, counter move type thing that we see all through Scripture, and we're seeing even in our time play out. So Satan knows about the rapture, and he's already set up sort of an excuse for it, which will be given. It'll be very interesting. I certainly won't be left behind when that event happens, but it'll be very interesting to watch that play out and to see if it really goes down, if people look at it, or do they kind of go, you know, if a lot of the population fall for it, or part of it falls, I think it may actually backfire, as most of this stuff does, and it will cause a lot of people to go, you know, something's going on here, and I knew this person, and he talked about this very thing, and maybe they'll access the Bite Show and hear it and realize that this is a satanic ruse, if you will, and maybe accept Jesus at that point and get saved and get through the tribulation.
Well, I have a question for both of you, and it came from an email. Someone that a few months ago asked this question, and I don't know exactly how to answer this myself, and that is, you know, in Scripture it talks about God will send a delusion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This person asked, what if there, or could there be a false rapture as prior to the real one, for people to, you know, to mislead people, to do whatever, you know, carry out some agenda that they're trying to do to us. That was a, you know, I thought about that, and I thought, oh, my gosh. I mean, is there any indication that right there, that could happen, that people would be removed under very false pretenses? You know, not by God, not by his angels.
Well, if you think about it, Georgianne, when we talk about the rapture, we're talking about the sudden removal of everyone who is born again. That's beyond Satan's capacity. He is a creature.
I agree with that.
So if I don't know that he has the capacity to recreate anything on that kind of a scale, where there's a sudden, instantaneous atomos, it says, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, those that are in the grave, the corruption shall put on incorruption, mm-hmm. and those who are mortal, those who haven't died, shall put on immortality. And it's just in the flick of an eye, mm-hmm. Satan doesn't have that capacity.
Right.
So whatever he has, he will be confined to the limits of who he is as a created being. And remember, as a created being, when he fell, he lost some of his operating assets.
Yes.
In other words, he's not as equal as he was before he fell. Yes,
right.
he is great in the sense of compared to unglorified humanity,
right.
But he is not compared to that which is still part of the elect angels. So we have to remember that what God pulls this off, that's not a good way to put it. When this finally comes down, it'll be without precedent. And there's you know, when we compare God with Satan, Satan never can counterfeit God.
Right.
The only way he can counterfeit God, Georgianne, is if those who do not know God.
Yes.
If we know God, Satan cannot, because if he could counterfeit God, he'd have to be equal. He's not. He's infinitely less. So those who know their God and know the Word, they will not be deceived. And so my response to that, he's going to be operating in the realm of signs, wonders, and miracles. Mm-hmm. And those who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, they're going to ooh and ah, as Lynn has said. If they look up and see a 3-mile-wide apparition that looks like a spacecraft, maybe it'll be that, or maybe it'll be a morphing fallen angel. Whatever, they're going to be awestruck. And we who know our Lord, we shouldn't be, you know, what is that to us? Really, what is that to us? And so maybe you want to comment on that. I don't have anything more to say.
Well, I think you covered it. I would agree. I don't think that, you know, the elect would be deceived if that were possible. And the word is getting out, and more people. Look, when I first got into this stuff, you know, well over 20 years ago, you just didn't mention it in church circles. I mean, you just didn't mention it at all. And then when the Nephilim book came out, it was sort of like, really sort of one of the first books out of the chute, even though it was a novel, that sort of opened up the can of worms of Genesis 6 and the whole deal. And since then, that was in 99, so it's 11 years ago, and now we've got conferences that are taking place. Your work, Doug, Russ Dizdar's work, Joe Jordan, Tom Horn, I mean, the list is, you know, it's about 20 people that are talking about this, you know, incessantly on different radio shows, talk shows. And what we've seen in the last, let's say, 11 years, you know, UFO hunters, all these, the Nostradamus effect on the History Channel, we see more and more shows, and of course, more television shows, more movies. Just last year, we had Knowing, District 9, The Fourth Kind, Race to Witch Mountain. I blogged about these movies. And what they do is they set up those people who are not born again and that look at all this through a scriptural lens. They set them up to accept the alien gospel, the alien lie. That's what these shows and these movies do. But counterbalancing that is the people that I just mentioned, Doug and Russ Dizdar and Joe Jordan and Tom Horn, David Flynn, Michael Heiser, Stephen Ulish, Bruce Collins, myself, and others that are constantly pointing to this coming great deception and really sounding a clarion cry against it to try to warn not only the church, but, you know, non-believers. You know, let me close up by saying this. Every time I'm on Coast to Coast, and I've been on that show like 8 times, and I don't say that to brag about it or pat myself on the back. It's a great opportunity to reach an audience, because most of that audience have no religious paradigm. They're they're not in the churches as we know it. And I present myself in a very non-religious way, refuse to talk Christianese, and just just kind of come off as a straight shooter, but present the gospel in a way that they can accept it. I'll call the Bible the guidebook of the supernatural. We get people emailing us asking, where can I get the guidebook to the supernatural?
Oh, that's perfect. Oh, how beautiful.
That's what they do. They want it. They're hungry for it.
Yes.
But see, the church has obfuscated it by churchianity and religiosity and, you know, all these rules and the do's and the don'ts and all this craziness, which has really obfuscated the simplicity of the gospel message. So, you know, we get, I don't know, we probably get like 1,000 emails every time I go on from people. Lots of people out there researching. And more and more people, for instance, there's one, let me close by saying this, one person exactly from my being on Coast to Coast contacted me. Her name is Lynn Dickey.
Yeah.
And she contacted me. She was an experiencer at this point. She was actually communicating with these beings telepathically. She believed that she was a chosen one, past incarnation lives. She was here to do this great work with these so-called beings. And I told her, I said, Lynn, her name is L-Y-N-N-E, Lynn Dickey. I said, these beings lie. They lie all the time. They're not what you think. They are from the pit of hell and they're fallen angels. Well, she nosed around a bit more, talked to a few other people. Anyway, to cut to the chase, she became born again. Now she's on talk shows.
Wow.
Talking about the very thing, how she was able to get out of the deception that she was completely immersed in, and it was killing her. I mean, her health, she had lost a lot of weight, she was having health problems, and all this other stuff. And this is exactly what we see with these entities when they begin to, you know, a person begins to engage with them. It leads literally to death, is what it will eventually do.
Yeah.
They become demonized, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, you know, while I have you, Lynn, there's this passage that often people will quote to demonstrate that these could not have been fallen angels that cohabited with women in Genesis 6. I'm going to read from Matthew 22:30 and make a comment on it and let you elaborate. Jesus, they came to the, there was the Sadducees are asking a question about the resurrection. And it's kind of, they're trying to trap Jesus because they didn't even believe in the resurrection. And Jesus said in verse 29, he says, you are mistaken and not understand the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage or but are like the angels, that is mankind. They're like the angels in heaven. And so when people look at that, they say, well, see, the point is what he's saying. Angels don't marry. They don't have offspring. They're like the angels in heaven. They don't marry. So in the resurrection, the mankind is not going to be married or producing children. And so they're like the angels in heaven. So they use that as a proof text. But it actually, it's just the opposite. The angels in heaven don't marry, but it doesn't say anything about the angels that rebelled and left their abode, their jurisdiction, and abandoned their habitation. And in Genesis 6, as we see, in Jude chapters, verse 6,
uh-huh.
and Second Peter 2:4, they are not the angels of heaven. They're not the elect angels. They're the rebellious ones.
Uh-huh.
And so, when that verse has been brought up, have you come across that, or have you responded in any way about that particular verse? And as people who say that that's proof that that this could not have occurred in Genesis 6 by citing Matthew 22:30.
Well, and that's what people, you know, are always pointing to. That says it'll be, you know, but it says nothing about, it certainly says that given in marriage, angels don't do that, that's fine, we'll be like them. But it never says anything that they're not sexless, or that, you know, and we see with the fallen angels, that's exactly what happened. I believe it, you know, it's looking at the text, and I'm trying to find this, one of these translations in Genesis 6:4 is this. In those days, and even afterwards, okay, when the evil beings from the spirit world were sexually involved with the human woman, their children became giants, of whom so many legends are told. So, I mean, that's another translation of Genesis 6:4. Mm-hmm. Isn't that interesting? And this, of course, has been sort of kept out of the church because it speaks of the unspeakable. I mean, it's the sum of all fears. It's beyond the pale. You know, fallen angels cohabiting with the daughters of men. People don't want to go there.
Yeah, it provokes a lot of questions.
It does.
The
what we see.
It's the supernatural view versus the non-supernatural or the rationalistic view.
Yeah. Augustine, right. Correct.
Yes.
I would agree.
Well, Lynn, if people wanted to go to your website, could you just talk a little bit about what you have on the website? You also have a blog, and so people could contact you?
Sure. Everything is lamarzulli.net, 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 and it's got links to the blog, links to the radio show, links to the news magazine. We've got a ton of stuff in the store. Of course, my books, Politics, Prophecy, and the Supernatural. The Nephilim Trilogy is in the process of getting reprinted, so you can't get that yet. But there's a wonderful DVD on the Shroud of Turin, which I find just absolutely fascinating. Another DVD on the Star of Bethlehem, a DVD on Roswell. We've got other books for sale. A lot going on in the store. The monthly news magazine is $18 a year. It's an e-magazine. You get a link and it comes as a PDF file. Dr. Stephen Ulish, Dr. Mike Heiser, Bruce Collins, and Gordy Tong all write columns pretty much on a monthly basis for the magazine. I interview different people. Last month was Guy Malone, part two. But we've had a variety of people from all different paradigms and backgrounds come in, sit-down interviews. They're written interviews, so nothing is taken out of context. It's literally verbatim. What you write in what the interview says, or the interviewee says in those interviews, comes to you, the reader, exactly like they say it. There is no editing or cherry picking of quotes. This is it. So it's sort of interesting that way. And of course, it's called TPNS News Mag, Politics, Prophecy, and the Supernatural, and we talk about all three of those different aspects and how they interface with each other. So lamarzulli.net, you can get to the blog from there, which is lamarzulli.wordpress.com, right from the main site, go right to the blog. I blog 5 days a week, variety of things. We get between 3,000 and 4,000 people a day visiting the blog, and our numbers are growing. So it's cutting edge, different things. It's whatever's going on in the world that I feel like writing about, and commenting about, and calling people's attention to, that's what I'll blog about. So that's lamarzulli.net. That's the website.
How about any upcoming conferences that you think people would gain advantage of?
Sure. I'll be speaking in St. Louis, Missouri on the 9th and 10th of April. And then towards the latter part of the month, I'll be in Nashville speaking at a conference there. Of course,
in the days, right?
Yes, correct. And looking forward to both of those venues. It should be fun. I just finished, not last weekend, but the weekend before, sort of a marathon. I was the only speaker at a conference in Cheyenne. It was really just a wonderful time. And I spoke for basically three segments, 2 hours each, 6 hours of material, tons of material. And what was really rewarding for me is at the last hour, as I began to connect the dots, I could see the light bulbs going off in people's heads all across the room. It was exciting to see that. Because, you lay this stuff down precept by precept, and all of a sudden towards the end it was like, oh, my gosh, and the light bulbs started going off in people's heads. Really very rewarding.
And so would you say that the very core of that which really motivates you, Lynn, is one, to awaken the church to where we are in history, that we really are at the end of the end of this age. We, as the people of God, we need to wake up. And anything you would comment on that which really keeps you going day by day?
Well, look, this is all I do full time. I mean, I write, I research, I do radio shows, I blog, I talk to different people, I try to get out and out into the field as much as possible, although that's rare. There's a flap going on in Kansas we're trying to get to, but we need about $5,000 to bring a film crew in there. We really want to film it because it's an ongoing UFO flap, and we really want to get out there. But, funds, we need the funds to make it happen. Mm-hmm. This is all I do, and I'm obviously very passionate about it. I feel that time is short. The place to look is the Middle East. The key player there is Russia, to see if Russia aligns itself militarily with Iran and decides to pull the trigger. Something will happen there sooner than later. I believe that there is a calm before the storm. We're seeing it right now. Everyone's jockeying for position over there. Kings go to war in the spring. Spring is right around the corner. And the saber rattling has just been, through the roof. And yet, supernaturally, there is a calm before the storm, in my opinion. We're not seeing the kind of activity that we saw several months ago.
Yeah, and I think what you said is very important for people to understand that Israel is God's prophetic time clock. And since Israel became a nation in 1948, that is the closing act of this particular age in terms of this age being wound up in preparation for the coming Messiah.
Absolutely. So, couldn't agree with you more.
Yeah, so... But thank you so much, Lynn. Georgianne, do you have anything else you want to bring up?
Well, I'm just very grateful that Lynn Marzulli consented to come on the Bite Show, and he's welcome back should he choose to come back. I hope he will. And I
absolutely, Georgianne. Count on it.
Thank you. And you and Doug are wonderful together. I hope we will do this again also in addition to some independent files with you, Lynn. So, you know, Doug he's a mainstay here, and he has a huge listenership, and his audio files are they're a real blessing to a lot of people. So, just both of you, thank you so much for tonight, and God bless you both for the work that you're both doing.
Thank you too, Georgianne, for having us on.
God blessing you. Yeah.
Don't hang up. This is Georgianne Hughes with Douglas Riggs, and please go to the audio library, click on Douglas Riggs' name, his page will open up, and be sure to listen to Prerequisites for the Lord's Return. Douglas just finished part 7, and more is coming. So, very important information in these audio files that every person out there that loves Jesus Christ and believes in God should hear. So, God bless everyone on the planet, no matter where you are or who you are. God bless you. This is Georgianne Hughes with Douglas Riggs and special guest tonight, Lynn Marzulli, signing off. Good night, everybody.